Welcome back at Evolutionary Psychology. Today we are going to talk about the Great Transition. This is the story of becoming farmers and city dwellers. We investigate what is meant for the way we organize things, cooperate, and the way leadership operates. Is there a fundamental mismatch between the way we have evolved and the way modern society is organized? The transition of hunter-gatherers becoming farmers was with no doubt the most important moment in our history. It was the beginning of modern times, of technology, cities, states, and more general in the way we organize things in our modern day world. What happened at this crucial moment in time? This determined our entire future. In my opinion, it's more important than the Roman Empire, the discovery of the Americas, the Industrial Revolution, the World Wars of the 20th century, or the emergence of the computer. All those things wouldn't have happened if we have never settled down and left our life as hunter-gatherers behind us. The ideas in this video lean heavily on the thinking of Jared Diamond, especially his book Guns, Germs and Steel. This is one of the more brilliant books of our times. Also, his book The World Until Yesterday is one I can warmly recommend. Both are really marvelous works, densely packed with ideas and very well written. When you start reading, you won't stop, that I can promise you. One of the central theses of Diamond is this. Most people think agriculture was a form of progress. In fact, Diamond argues, it was not. But anyhow, the repercussions of it were huge and cannot easily be overstated. But first, let's have a look at the way the dispersion of men over the planet took place, because this is going to tell us a lot about what happened next. It all started in Africa. Once we were aquatic apes, later forced back to the savannas, helped in this dangerous transition by our greatest friend since then, the dog. We managed to survive and retain our special features, big brains, our unrivaled adaptability, language, tools, and above all, the ability to cooperate. This led us on the way to becoming one of the most successful species ever, at least as measured by our impact on the world. From Africa, we traveled to Europe and Asia, traveling meaning following game and moving to places with plenty of food to find. There was nothing of a plan, no route map, nothing of a well thought out intentions or to conquer the continents. This is why the progress is so slow and measured in meters a year. Only when Homo sapiens entered the Americas, we shifted gears and a quick conquering followed. And I don't mean the Spaniards, but the predecessors of the current Native Americans. This dates back to about 12,000 to 15,000 years back. A very noticeable feature of our traveling is that wherever we went, we left a trail of destruction behind us. When men appeared, big species died out. Sometimes within a few hundred years, up to a few thousand years after our arrival. But always, everywhere, the same thing happened. So, don't believe the myth ancient people were living in harmony with nature. They didn't. And among themselves, they surely didn't. War, destruction, and extinctions were rampant. Man had no idea of his limits and of the limits of the natural resources. They took everything that was available, not thinking about its future implications. The concept of sustainability was unknown to man, like it's almost unknown to any other life form. And when food went scarce, they simply could travel to new hunting fields. And this way, we spread around the world. Men always started with hunting big prey. Why? Probably because they provided the most food, but also, and this may seem strange, because they were relatively easy to hunt. Animals lose their shyness when they have no natural enemies. Maybe you have seen movies about the wildlife on the Galapagos Islands. These animals feel no fear for man at all. Why? The answer is, there are no predators on these islands, so being afraid serves no survival function. On land, you can approach an iguana, a big sea lizard, and you may even touch him. The animal will hardly notice you. But in water, there he is as shy as you may expect him to be, because there are predators to be alert on, like sharks, sea lions, and orcas. So, for example, when man entered the Americas, he found the giant ground sloth, a huge, peaceful, leaf-eating creature, easy to hunt, easy to kill, providing a lot of meat. But because the gentle giants procreate very slowly and were hunted easily, they were the first to disappear, followed by, among others, horses, mammoths and camels. Yes, all these species were once native to America. They got extinct, caused by man, and some came back later, like horses and camels, also caused by man. But this sad story is not only limited to the Americas. It's a universal pattern. Everywhere man appeared, big animals died out. Australia and New Guinea once were populated with a species of giant kangaroo. Diprodonts, a kind of marsupialum rhinoceros, as big as a cow, roaming the plains, accompanied by big ostriches weighing in more than 200 kilograms. In the jungle lived giant pythons, as well as big lizards and a 1 kg plus sized bush crocodile. New Zealand had his moas, big ostrich-like birds. On the islands of Hawaii, there lived a non-flying geese, and giant lemurs were once found on the island of Madagascar. All disappeared. The Dutch are known to have wiped out the dodo on St. Mauritius. And where did this bring us in the end? We can conclude we were nearly destructed ourselves by our own success as hunter-gatherers. We almost made the same mistake the pest bacteria made in our bodies, remember? Another way of putting this is this. We were lured into agriculture. Yes, lured. How did this happen? There's a simple logic behind it. What to do when no big animals are left? Well, you switch to smaller ones, but also more hard to catch medium-sized animals, which also provided less food. And if they are used up, well, hunt even smaller game, which is of course still even more hard to catch, and of course you need more of it to get the same amount of nutrition. So life grew increasingly difficult for our far ancestors. In the end, they had to decide when they caught, for example, a young animal, what to do. Eat it now, or let it grow big and fat and eat it later. And this is the first step toward agriculture and cattle herding. If you found a tree with delicious fruits, what do? Of course, you come back next year. But there's more you can do. Weed out competing plants around it, fence it, and you have even more fruits next year. One step further is you grow seeds of this special tree into new trees. This way, the first gardens came into existence. This, of course, didn't happen overnight. For a long time, there were intermingled forms of hunter-gatherers and prototypical forms of farming. But anyhow, it made people less mobile. And before we knew it, we had become farmers. But before we go into the farmer's life, let's have a closer look at the life of the hunter-gatherers. From research on their skeletons, we know they lead a quite healthy life, with little or no diseases, and they were physically bigger and stronger than the later farmers. They ate a lot of healthy proteins, fruits and plants, ideal for our human body. Furthermore, their working weeks were quite short. In a tropical climate, meat cannot be stored, so it's no use piling up big reserves of food and meat. Estimations are they worked about 15 hours a week, and the rest of the time they probably used for telling stories, having fun, dancing, making art, and decorating themselves. Did they live in a kind of paradise? Yes, partly they did. But mind you, there is another side of the story. Skeletons and archaeology are telling us. Men had severe wounds and often half-healed broken bones from hunting big game. Besides this, there was an abundance of male homicides. Want to know more about this? See my video on male-female differences and male aggression. In some recent and modern hunting tribes, 60% of the men die because of murder. Maybe paradise, but he didn't die peaceful of old age. But back to the sunny side. Standards of hygiene were high, not as a willful decision, but because they stayed only for a few weeks in the same place. No piling up of excrements and no animal excrements added to that, because they had no tamed animals. There were little or no infectious diseases. This all in contrast to the later farmers who were struck who were stuck to one area, piling up excrements of men and animals, and doing so creating a paradise for dangerous germs. Another positive aspect of the hunter-gatherers people is their way of making decisions. This was in fact quite modern, quite democratic. Everyone was involved in the discussion. Everyone had his say, with probably a bit more power for the stronger, smarter, older members of a tribe and the experts in some crafts, such as making spears, hunting different animals, knowing some terrain, having exceptional skills, etc. The concept of hierarchy based on power was unknown to them. Also, there was little or no wealth disparities. Tribes were mobile. They didn't have beasts of burden, no slave, no prisoners were captured in wars with other groups because you had no means of keeping them captured, and the concept of having employees was unknown to them. So, when you moved to another place, you had to carry all your possessions yourself. A crafty made spear, some firm animal skins, some decorations, and maybe a basket of food. In other words, you could only be that rich as you could carry yourself, causing a society with a very low Gini coefficient. They were quite egalitarian. Then, for the reasons we mentioned, man was slowly lured into agriculture. But where did it all start? The oldest form of agriculture took place in the Fertile Crescent in the Middle East, as well as in some other spots in the world, especially in Africa, China and Mesoamerica. The most important factor whether the transition from hunter to agriculture would take place had to do with the availability of species of animals and plants suited for domestications. And to be clear, not all species are. In fact, only a tiny minority of wild animals and plants can be domesticated. I'll explain more later about this. When we look at the most important domestications, we end up in some specific regions. In Southeast Asia, wheat, legumes, olives, sheep and goat were first domesticated. In China, rice, sorghum, pigs and silkworms. In Western Europe, poppies and oats. In the Indus Valley, sesame seeds, aubergine and the zebu. In Egypt, sycamore, chufa and the donkey and cat. In Mesoamerica, maize, beans, pumpkins and turkeys. In the Andes and the Amazon, potatoes, manioc, llamas and guinea pigs. In the eastern part of the USA, sunflowers were domesticated. In Africa, sorghum, Africa rice, guinea fowl, jam, oil palms, coffee and trefa. And in New Guinea, sugar canes and bananas. This seems an impressive list, but even more impressive it is to discover that these were almost all domestications possible. Out of the many millions of species of plants and animals that inhabit the world. And secondly, they took place in a relatively small span of time. A kind of time slot we met before. For the last 2000 years, almost no new domestications emerged. All species that could be domesticated were domesticated in a remarkable short span of time and space. Aboriginals were thought not to be intelligent enough to domesticate animals. But when Europeans arrived in Australia and tried it, they failed as well. No Australian animal can be domesticated. The continent is very barren, with only a few fertile areas. It had no volcanic activity, no mountains and glaciers to create rivers and fertile regions. So, the primitive state of the aboriginals were in had nothing to do with their IQ or lack of creativity, but everything with the circumstances they lived in. Absence of domesticated species forced them to stay hunter-gatherers, and this prevented the originating of technology, cities and state, that is, modern life. For other regions, other peoples and other species, the same story can be told. Elephants can be tamed, but they do not reproduce easily, so they never became a domesticated species. Eagles and cheetahs are excellent hunting companions, but are almost impossible to breed. So are cranes, hyenas and bears. African bush pig deliver excellent meat, but they cannot be tamed or bred in captivity. Zebras are fast running and strong, but again, they can't be tamed and used as mounted animals. Rodeo cowboys, champions in their sport, failed to catch a zebra with a lasso when they had no problems at all with horses or calves. Most biting accidents in zoos come from zebras. A horse accepts leadership, a zebra doesn't. The same goes for onagers in the Middle East. African rhinos would make perfect war machines, but again, untamable and not breeding easily in captivity. So, this explains why domestication, however important, was confined to relatively rare occasions. But when it happened, its impact was huge. One of the most brilliant ideas of Jared Diamond is his observation that America, Africa, and Indonesia, Australia all have a vertical gradient, and only Europe, Eurasia, India, China, and Japan are horizontal located on the globe, and therefore connected to each other in a very special way. All these regions share roughly the same climate, meaning that species of animals and plants living in one region can also live in another region. In other words, domestications are transferable along this horizontal axis, while on the other hand, vertical transfers are almost impossible. Take for example the llama, domesticated in the Andes. It would be very useful too in the dry, cold areas in the Northern America. These northern habitats would be ideal for this animal, but it never got there. Why? Because it had to pass the warm and humid Amazon regions. And this is almost impossible for the poor llama. He cannot stand the heat and humidity of a tropical jungle. Therefore, this technology, domesticating animals can be seen as technology, was confined to a narrow area in South America, while these inventions in the old world could spread freely along the horizontal line from Western Europe to Japan and all the regions in between. That's why this line is called the lucky latitude. All of the big five domestications, sheep, goat, cow, pig and horse, could all live in the Fertile Crescent and in every other part of the lucky latitude. While in other spaces in the world, inventions were kept hidden in isolated pockets. In Eurasia, they freely spread around across this horizontal line. As we have seen, when inventions come together, when ideas are having sex, even more innovations will emerge. A truly self-enhancing process, a positive feedback loop, leading to the most remarkable cultures we have ever seen so far. That's why we find the biggest of civilizations with the greatest impact on this horizontal line. Think of the Fertile Crescent, Egypt, the Indus Valley, China, Japan, and of course Greece, Rome, and later the northern parts of Western Europe. But did it make people happier? Yes. For some it was a paradise, but no, for the masses of common people. Colin Touch characterized farming as end of Eden, and he had good reasons to do so. Take for example health problems of the new farmers. Skeletons tell us a grim story. The comfortable 15 hours of working a week increased to 60 hours and more. The strenuous physical work showed in the skeletons of people living in that areas and ages. Their bodies are remarkably shorter. Maybe that's why farmers had tales about giants, the still remaining hunters they met from time to time. The skeletons of farmers showed more deformations, mainly caused by diseases, malnutrition, and strenuous monotonous work. Their diet was less healthy and changed from proteins and fruits to beans and carrots. Infectious diseases became a kind of repeating plagues, caused by piling up of human and animal excrements. A paradise for germs. For the first time in history, man lived in permanent contact with animals, causing some diseases to spread from animals to man, the so-called zoonosis. From cows, we got tuberculosis, measles and smallpox. Pigs caused the whooping cough and influenzas. Birds, chicken and ducks brought in other kinds of influenzas. And more recently, apes were the prime causes of Ebola and AIDS, and bats carried COVID-19 with them. The earliest stories in the Old Testament can be positioned in a time around the first farmers emerging. And what do we see there? The tales and commandments in those Bible books, for a big part, handle about hygiene rules, lockdowns, symptoms, diagnosis and quarantines. Infectious diseases were a main cause of concern by them. It took ages for people in the old world to build up effective resistance. But we did. It was dramatically demonstrated when Hispanics conquered America. American natives died by the tens of millions of infectious diseases Europeans long had built up immunity for. Agriculture not only had a big influence on our health, but also on our social life and the way we organized our society. Hunter-gatherers lived in small bands with strong family ties. There was little disparities in wealth and power. Joint decision-making was the common rule, and there was relatively little room for division of labor, or becoming highly specialized. Hunter-gatherers were sometimes very violent, both within their groups as well as outside tribes, but they had no slaves nor employees. This all changed with agriculture. Something completely new emerged: ownership of land, estate property. Of course, hunter-gatherers had their territories too, but specific pieces of ground owned by one person were completely unknown to them. This changed when people built gardens and arable lands. They had to, of course, when you want to protect and enjoy your crops and the fruits of your labor. At first, one man or a family group worked at their own fields, but soon they started to hire people. Probably these were part-time hunter-gatherers in times of scarcity of game. They paid them with food, but of course less than their factual production was worth. The owner kept a surplus of production for himself, probably to buy more ground, tools or hands with. This way, the owner of land grew richer and richer, owning more and more land. For the first time in history, substantial accumulation of wealth, power and land ownership took place, and this process goes on till this very day, as the French economist Thomas Piketty has firmly demonstrated. Also, for the first time in history, a serious division between the haves and the have-nots was seen. Marx had his work cut out. Settlement, villages and in the end cities emerged. More and more division of labor took place. Everyone specialized in his own profession, working with other professionals to achieve a level of technological advancement never seen before. Some of these professionals were soldiers, paid and commanded by the people in power, the people with money and land. Economic power transferred into political and military power. For the first time in history, prisoners of wars were not killed, but kept as slaves, adding even more to the accumulation of wealth and power in the hand of a small elite. Did the world become more violent by the rise of the warrior class? Yes and no. For the first time, large-scale battles took place, kings trying to rob the wealth of other kings. Many common men died, but at the other hand, the people in power had nothing to gain by their workers killing each other. So warriors also operated as police forces, keeping the peace, if must, with violence. The statistics show overall less people, especially men, died because of violence. This new way of living also led to a new way of leadership and fundamentally different forms of religion. First, have a look at leadership. In essence, leadership changed from competence-based to being based on power, that being based on wealth. In hunter-gatherers communities, we saw simple forms of division of labor, which led to situational forms of leadership. When hunting deer, the best deer hunter was in charge. Catching fish, the expert on catching fish gave the most commandments and instructions. Leadership was visible. Everyone could see if the leader did well or not, and if no good, his mates would no longer accept his leadership in the future. Performance was direct, clear and visible. But now, with land ownership growing bigger and bigger, the landowner delegated tasks to his middle management. Leaders became big leaders, became barons and noblemen, became kings, and with this, leadership became increasingly more invisible. A further step was that the power grew into something you inherited from your family. Skills became less important, bloodlines did. In the past, leadership was situational and flexible. Now, in agricultural societies, it became fixed on people in power and their descendants. Monarchies and hierarchies were created. resting on the economic, political and military power, but also protected by new myths, for example, myths about the special quality of the nobility. New forms of leadership led to new forms of religion. For hunter-gatherers, everything had a spirit, everything had agency. People, animals, rivers, the sun. When your child drowned in a river, the river was angry. When it provided fish, it was benevolent. In this world of spirits, not necessarily metaphysical of nature, there was no hierarchy. Just like in the community of people, in the community of spirits, it's a hodgepodge of voices and powers, leading in some messy way to certain outcomes or decisions. For this theater, there were no fixed rules, no written laws or dogmas. Everyone had direct contact with these forces, of which no fixed images were made. Models of the entities in this world were made by personal individual experience and by stories told within the tribe. The focus of the hunter-gatherers was on the here, the now and the near future. The question, for example, who created this world, was a non-issue. We had to wait until later craftsmen, builders and technology came into existence, before this question drove itself so powerful to the forefront. The agricultural society, cities and monarchies had a hierarchical power structure. One king at the top and beneath him a pyramid of people with different degrees of power. This model was copied to religion. We call this monotheism. The idea originated in the oldest agricultural civilization, the ones from Babylonians and Egyptians. Moses, for example, probably was an Egyptian prince, taking monotheism to the Jewish people, from which it spread to Christianity and later to Islam. The model of metaphysics mimics the actual model of society. God is an all-powerful and rules over all matters. He's invisible and communicates through a pipeline of persons and entities, archangels, angels, prophets, popes, bishops and priests, having special skills in elucidating the intentions of the deity. God is far away and difficult to understand. This requires the introduction of a new dimension in life, the dimensions of the metaphysical, of course only understandable for the initiated. Like rules, laws and accounts, with the invention of writing, things were now for the first time fixated in codes and protocols, just so in religions, here called holy scriptures. So we have to realize hierarchy in organization, society and religion, as we know it today, is not something that fits in neatly in our evolution-based intuitions, emotions and inner drives about cooperation, ownership and leadership. Hierarchy is new and a relatively late invention. It does not fit natural with our evolutionary mental software. But in spite of this, it was the dominant way of organizing since about 10,000 years back. Think of the Egyptian pharaohs, the Roman empires, the Catholic Church, empires in the Middle Ages, and not to forget the factories in the Industrial Revolution. It has shown to be effective, however alien to individual people themselves. But now, in the 21st century, it seems like it's meeting its boundaries. In our modern age, people are looking for new ways of organizing. Think of autonomous workforces, like in the Brazilian company Semco, owned by the charismatic Ricardo Semler. We see empowerment movements and ideas like deep democracy. I think these are all movements back to our evolutionary roots, to working together and to leadership as we have experienced this since millions of years. Can we go back to the ways hunter-gatherers practice leadership? Yes and no. On the one side, our world has grown so complex that longing back to an ancient time like this is naive. But on the other hand, we cannot go on like we did in the first phases of the Industrial Revolution. The way we run the world today is detrimental to Earth and to people. And one way or the other, we have to find new modes, more durable and more sustainable. What will be the final solution? I don't know. But we have to keep on searching. And I'm convinced evolutionary psychology will play a major role in this. Okay, folks, that was it for today. Thanks for listening and I hope you enjoyed it. See you again. If you like this video, don't forget to like and subscribe.